Thank you. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We're going to rise, those who are able to be on their feet, and sing hymn 251, as you have it on your programs, before we go to the opening prayers. I hope my mic is... Can we sing 251, those who are pitching us songs? Let us be seated and pray. Morena le modimo wa rena. Wena tata rena wa le godimo. We come before your throne of grace, your throne of honor this morning in thanksgiving for all the wonderful things that you continue to do with and for us, because you remain our God and we are children. We come before you, Heavenly Father, humbled by the developments of the day, that we sit here in mourning and in grief, and yet your Son has come out, and yet you have awakened us from our deep sleep of last night. You have done all what we know you for. And therefore, as we gather here this morning, we are thankful for life. We are thankful just for being here. Guide us and lead us. Assume your role of leadership as we wrestle with this service of grief and mourning. Make us understand those things that you have chosen for us to understand. And those that we shall fail to understand, we will understand that it is not for us, but for you. Because at the end, you remain God. We pray for each and every one of us who gathers here this morning. We pray even for those who shall come to pay tributes, that guide their tongues, manage their emotions, and out of their tributes must come healing and comfort to the family and to the nation. Our Father, who art in heaven, be thy name, thy kingdom come, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Is the kingdom thee, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Abusheni, Dumelang. My name is Oscar Shimange. Together with Ms. Mulebuheng Kadimeng, we are going to lead you through this program today. I'd like to take this opportunity to specifically acknowledge the Tlakula family and the Mphahlele family. We share with you in your sorrow. Be comforted and accept our sincere condolences, more especially to Sister Flo and the family. Just a bit of housekeeping. As we know, why we gathered here, we gathered because we are one family with one sole purpose of coming to bid a final farewell to Dr. P.P. Tlakula, who I've always called Bra Peter, and those who were with him at school call him Bra Peter. So knowing him as a man who always liked order, always punctual, always disciplined, I'm sure the least we can do is to show him that respect. We mustn't assume that COVID is over, so let's all observe all the basic COVID rules, keep our masks on. But today I'll make an exception for the people who are going to speak. I think it makes a lot of sense. Fortunately, there is social distancing. You can take off your mask during the time when you're speaking, because we are not all gifted with hearing. Some of us look at your mouth, at your lips, and then we can make out what you are saying. I know we have got a very big epidemic of cell phones. I'd like to request everyone at this time to put their cell phones on silent. If you can't put it on silent, switch it off. It's only for a short time. Even if it rings, there's nothing you can do, so that we can focus our attention to what we have come for. Another part of housekeeping, for those where nature calls, right at the back, on my right, on your left, we have got ablution facilities for males and for females. Before I proceed with the program, I'm going to hand over to my co-program director also to give some few remarks. Thank you.
Good morning, Abusheni, Dr. Shimange. It's such an honor and a privilege to co-steer this program this morning with you, Reverend Badagi, and all the religious leaders present in our midst. We thank you for being here to lead us and guide us in this program this morning. My heartfelt condolences and greetings to my family, Bagatlagula and Pahlele, extended relatives, esteemed colleagues of the members of South African Medical Association and other industry colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, those who've also joined us virtually, all protocol observed. My name, as I said, is Lebo Lebereng Kadimeng. I'm a niece to Dr. Flora, and it's such a privilege for me to stand here this morning and steer this program as we celebrate the life of a well-lived man, a giant, Dr. Maladi Pesi Tlagula. As my co-steer has said, that the bathrooms are at the back, cell phones obviously to please observe that protocol. Also, any emergencies that may occur, we've got our exits at the back, those are two. And obviously, I think if we have any medical emergencies, I think we are well covered in this area with a number of doctors in our midst. I'm also going to ask a niece or a nephew to please assist us in terms of sitting by closer to the podium to ensure that as all the speakers come up, we are sanitized and we observe the COVID protocols. Today, ladies and gentlemen, we gather, as I said, to celebrate the life of a medical giant, a man of a formidable legacy, somebody who actually embodies and lives the saying that says, African child, it's possible, as he became one of the first black gynecologists in this area of Ekurhuleni, somebody who was an inspiration to many and a leader in this formidable medical career. He was also a family man, a wonderful husband, father, uncle, and also grandfather. A dedicated and excellent medical professional who served his community with humility, diligence, respect, and professionalism. On Monday in the memorial service, the pastor asked us or requested us that as we mourn and celebrate this giant that has fallen, we ask ourselves, Where do we stand with God? Which path are we leading? Are we going to be able to say that when the time comes that I have lived a purposeful life, I have embodied the same principle as this man that we are celebrating today? As you all sit here and we listen to speaker after speaker, you ask yourself that question again, that will people say the same thing? Will this man who has done so much and opened doors for all of us standing here and sitting, that have we embodied the same principles and the same humility as Dr. Tlakula? I thank you.
Thank you, Mulebihi. We are now going to start with our program. We are all aware of why we are here, but I think we need to really, really be made more aware. Without wasting any time, I'm going to call Dr. Khensani Tlakula to come and announce the death, Kuvika Nkosi, Dr. Khensani Tlakula. And after he has announced, we'll all sing hymn 171.
Risana wa mina wa ndi randa rirandura munura hela kutsaka ku hatla kuhunda wena ntsena Shikwembu shanga wa ndiranda.
Nkomo, thank you, program director. Mina emina Khensani Tlakula, and ni rumwile ku tantapika nkosi namuntla. Nkosi wa Piet Percy Malati Tlakula. Papa Ntsongo wa mina. Ni vikela n'wina va ka Tlakula, n'wina va ka Xivambu, ni vikela na n'wina va ka Pandeka, n'wina va ka Mphahlela, na n'wina maxaka a vanghana va yena ompi wa mina loyi, ni vaakatiko lava nga kona laha namuntlha. Papa Ntsongo Piet va hi siyile. He passed on the 27th of January 2022 following an illness, septicemia. He was first admitted on the 18th of November following a myocardial infarction, which is just a heart attack. He was then scheduled for a bypass operation on his heart, which was done on the 9th of December. While in hospital, he tested positive for COVID on the 22nd of December. His health took a turn for the worst on the 24th of January, following the septicemia, and ultimately passed on the 27th. He was COVID negative at his death when he passed. So indeed, Navika, nivikela swinene nene n'wina vaka Tlakula mi nga tshamala. Na n'wina va ka Mphahlela, swi tiveni ku murhandziwa wa n'wina Piet u hi siyile. Hi vika hi ri na xivavi xikulukumba ngopfu. Hi vika ku mi swi tiva ku Antiflora va lovele hi nuna. Lebogang na Dineo va lovele hi papa vona. Malati na Mulebogeng ba lobele kokwana wa bona wa xinuna. Hina vaka Xivambu hi lovele hinena. We announce our heartbreaking loss of our giant in our family. Swi tiveni n'wina vangati ya Eliu, n'wina vangati ya Molombo, n'wina vangati ya Rirhale, n'wina va madya ya Fularela, kunene ya hina yi etlerile. Inkomu.
Ndi kondandi yafika kufe wandi randa de anyela yeso wanin ndi tsakela kuranda uyena swanandi akuyimbelela wandi randa mbilu yanga hambe yekweha wandi randa ni lokondi twako karala wandi randa ndingakarati wa hisivi ndekarele kuva xityohi kambe a ndi tseke kuvula wa ndi randa
Nda swi tiva ku ri hi le nkosini win I know that we are at a funeral but knowing Bra Peter he'll have liked us to sing not to mumble so I think with the next few hymns we are going to sing we won't mumble I don't know if it will be a bad idea to open the doors for more ventilation because it's getting a bit hot. I think it will help us quite a lot. Now, I'm going to make a request, and I think we agree with my co-program director, Ms. Molobegeng Nkadimeng, that we need to control our speeches, maximum 5 minutes. I'm not going to cough when I think you are exceeding your time. I'll just start looking around like this. Then that will deliver the message. This is that so that we can keep in time. I'm going to make only one exception. Our first two speakers who are going to pay tribute, Dr. Abner Tlakula and Dr. Nkele Lisiya. I think I'll give them a bit of liberty. Please bear with me. What I'm going to do, I'm not going to stand up every time when one speaker finishes to call the next one. I'll give you the names so that when one finishes, the other one can stand up. When one finishes, the one can stand up. The first two speakers will be Dr. Abner Tlakula and Dr. Nkele Lisiya. After that, we'll have the hymn, Come, Come, Ye Saints. If there's somebody who can start the hymn for us, please do so. And then after that, I'm going to ask Mr. Ralph Motiba on behalf of friends, and then the family friend, Ms. Sriana Maisela. Then I'll stand for a minute before the next ones.
Just a quick announcement. We are urgently looking for Dr. Matabani to please go with Gidi for a family emergency. Dr. Matabani, can you kindly be with Gidi? She's waving her hand and she needs you. Thanks.
Ai komu eka mfambisi wa ntirho wa hina wa namuntlha Dr. Ximangi eka manani Flora Tlakula our sister eka mfundisi Pataki neka n'wina hinkwenu vakhandli va nhlonge in Shangan we call mourners vakhandli va nhlonge which translate to the people who prepare the skin, because in olden days at a burial the body used to be put into a bag made of skin. That is why mourners were called vakhandli va nhlonge. I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We members of the Tlakula family are truly devastated by the passing of our dear brother. Peter, I can't use the name doctor. After all, he's only my younger brother. Peter spent his last month as a patient at R-Vape Hospital in Kempton Park. The Tlakula family wishes to thank all members of staff at R-Vape who were involved in caring for him. We thank the doctors, we thank the nursing staff, the administrative staff, and the housekeeping staff. Many of these caregivers knew Peter personally, and they applied skill with love and with care. We are truly grateful to them. Peter had a very special relationship with the maternity ward staff at Zamukuhle Hospital in Tembisa. We thank them for supporting him, for making his work bearable, for making his work enjoyable. Peter worked within the communities of Tembisa, Kempton Park, and Benoni for more than 40 years. We are sincerely grateful for the acceptance and support that he received from these communities throughout these many years. This support gave him his livelihood. You know, doctors depend on patients for their livelihood. So we truly thank the support of this community for Peter giving. They also gave him joy, and they also gave him a sense of fulfillment. For 40 years, he worked in these communities. We also thank and are very grateful to his colleagues, his medical colleagues in all these communities. They supported him and helped his practice and helped his patients. Peter's practice was always a solo practice. He never practiced in partnership with another doctor. He was always on his own in the practice. And over these 40 years, there are some people who were his assistants. There were people who worked with him, who were his assistants, nurses, clerks, and so on. We sincerely thank those people for helping him work at his practice and helping his patients. And we pray that now that he has departed, they should be blessed by the Holy Lord and find other places of employment. Baha Mphahlele. Bahampahlele, starting with Auntie Flo, embraced Peter and embraced all of us, members of the Tlakula family. We are very grateful to that. Flo, I use that word knowingly. This is how Peter referred to his dear wife, Flora. He used to call her Flo. Thank you for giving your love to Pete. And that's another word that we use lovingly. We didn't call Peter doctor. We didn't call Peter. We called him Pete because this is the name that we normally used. So, Flo, we thank you for giving Pete your love. You accepted Pete and loved him, accepting his rough edges with love and tolerance. Pete had a happy and peaceful life. You know that it is a big thing to be happy and peaceful. And it is through Flo that Pete enjoyed such a life. You gave your all during his illness. Yeah, that's Flo. Flo was with the doctors. She consulted with the doctors at every turn. When they made a big decision, Flo was there with them to make the decision. Flo prayed for Pete's recovery. Thank you very much, Flo. We pray for you, and we pray that God should bless you. Lebogang and Dineo, we thank you for the love you gave to your daddy. That's another word that was used by the family. The Dineo and Lebogang called a Pete daddy. We thank you for the love you gave your daddy, love. You allowed your daddy full access to his grandchildren, Malati and Mulebogeng. May Almighty God bless you. Peter had a very special place in his heart for children. It's quite amazing. You know, Peter was a big guy. But he had a very special place in his heart for children. We adults often look upon children as a nuisance. They must go and play far away. Peter befriended children. Malati, who is now 12 years old, and Mulebogeng, who is 7, were Peter's buddies. They were his friends. And he enjoyed playing with them. And they also enjoyed playing with him. Here, Master of Ceremonies, I'll depart a little bit from my talk about Peter, and try to. It's actually related to Peter. You know, Peter. When I remember him, he was somebody who had. A very strong will to go forward. You know, he was committed. When he studied, he did so with with very strong resolve. Yeah. He didn't accept a failure. He went through medicine, he went through BSc. By the way, at our home, there were five of us. And Peter, we didn't consider Peter the most intelligent. Yeah. We actually considered Kensani, the younger brother, the intelligent guy. But even though we looked down upon Peter, because of his determination, he went through the BSc. He went through the, in fact, when he went to TEFLOP for BSc, and when he got to TEFLOP, one professor said, "Wena, you mustn't do BSc, you must do BA." And Peter said, "Never." With his resolve, he went through BSc in 3 years. And then he said, "Look, guys, I'm now going for medicine." And he went through medicine in the record time. And then after medicine, he said, "Guys, I'm now going to be a specialist." And there he became a specialist. We who thought were more intelligent than him could never face it. Yeah. I was just saying that Peter indeed had a very special place in his heart for children. Now, here's the little thing that I wanted to share with you. I want to share this quotation with you. The quotation reads, "The work of children is play. The work of children is play." Now, maybe you know that there are schools called Montessori. There are schools which are called Montessori schools. Now, Montessori's, that quotation is from a lady called Mary Montessori, who started the Montessori way of teaching children. And what she says is that children, when they are at play, they are actually at work. When they are at play, they are actually at work. And during this work, they learn very important skills. They learn things like endurance. You know, some people can endure, can read overnight. We used to call it cross night. They can endure. Now, according to Montessori, those skills are learned in childhood. Those skills are learned between the ages of 4 years and 9 years. So when children come play around, enrich their play, make it richer, because by so doing, you are doing your duty as a parent. Because children, their first teacher, the first teacher of parents is their, of children is their parents. Yeah, I say this remembering that Peter had endurance. Probably he learned it in his childhood. Yeah, I won't carry on forever along this theme. But those of you who don't believe what I'm saying, please go and Google it. Please go and Google it. You'll see that indeed I'm telling the truth. Yeah. N'wina vaka xivambu na maxaka ya hina hinkwenu ka n'wina. Hi khensa vukona bya n'wina. Hi khensa ku yi chavelela ka n'wina. Hi khensa na rirhandzu eka loyi makwerhu evuton'wini bya yena. Inkomu. Funerals are very expensive occasions. We thank you for your generous donations. May I single out one donor. I'm doing something which is very unusual. But may I single out one donor who donated 75,000 rand towards this funeral, which is Sizwe Medical Fund. Funerals require hands to do the work. You know, it's amazing how much work funerals create. I noticed that the women do most of the work. Thank you very much, ladies. Finally, may Almighty God, who is loving and gracious, who is forgiving, and who gave us his son to suffer on our behalf and died on the cross so that our sins be forgiven. May God Almighty accept our Peter in heaven.
Now it's time for Dr. Kelelisia.
Program directors, Reverend Pataki, the Takula and Patele family, ladies and gentlemen, I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I stand on this podium to represent the Patele family, Bakhotsi Baga Takula. Abut Peter got married to our sister Flora during 1988. When our mother died 3 years down the line in 1991, our youngest brother Madumi was only 12 years old. House Flora, being the eldest in our family, the eldest daughter in our family, took over the role of parents to her siblings. Abut Peter was a great Ramuholu to our children. Not only was he Ramuholu to the immediate Mpahlele family, he was Ramuholu to the extended Mpahlele nephew and nieces. They call themselves COCs, which stands for Circle of Cousins. He was full of humor and was always ready to provide advice, especially on education and business. Life was an emotional roller coaster since Abut Peter got admitted to hospital. We prayed, some of us went on a fast, as we were asking for divine intervention. But finally, when the Lord provided healing. It wasn't the kind of healing we were hoping for at that time. But as Christians, we submit to the will of God, and we accept that our Peter has gone to a better place where there's no pain, no suffering. Ausflora, Dineo, Lebogang, the grandchildren Malati and Mulebogeng, the entire Tlakula family, as well as Aunt Pule. Mudimu one arifile Abut Peter, Mudimu uwile umujir. Let us take comfort from the book of Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. And I quote, "Come unto me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest." Let us release the spirit of our wood Peter to his creator, where he will rest in eternal peace. As much as we are overwhelmed by grief, we need to remain strong in faith and in prayer. The Lord is our good shepherd. The Holy Word assures us that the Lord is closer to those that are mourning. Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. This is the time that we need to raise our eyes, cast our eyes upon the cross where our Lord Jesus Christ died for us. It is going to be tough. We are crying, and many more tears will still be shed. But as we are crying, we should not cry like people who don't have any faith. We should remain strong in our Christian faith. May the spirit of our beloved Abut Peter rest in peace and rise in glory. I thank you.
Let's come near before the last speaker finishes for the sake of time. And as Bra Peter will say, the rule of five is now going to apply strictly. I was just giving an exception for the first two speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, program directors. Let me begin by greeting the Tlakula family, the Mbatlele family, and all other relatives, friends, and all of us who are gathered here this morning to come and pay tribute to one of our own, to come and celebrate Peter's life. I stand here as a friend. I stand here as a person who enjoyed Peter's presence in my life, which was never toxic. I first met Peter in 1975 when I started working in Tembisa at Tembisa High School as a teacher. But as the years went by, we came very, very close because of certain qualities that he had and the kind of person to whom I could relate from time to time. He was a brother, a friend, a confidant, a happy-go-lucky somebody. And now recently, I think for the past 5-6 years, he never referred to me as Ralph. When he called me on the phone almost every week or after 2 weeks just to chat, he'd say, "Hey, Madala, how's it, Madala?" Then I'd say, "Madala, hey, I'm okay." That's how he addressed me, and I addressed him that way. And he had a certain kind of laughter. If there was something that got him excited, either way, negatively or positively, and he could exclaim and say, "Hey, well, can you believe it? Can you believe it, Madala?" And I said, "Hey, man, I don't know. Can you just explain to me?" He said, "Hey, some of these things are not what we're supposed to be seeing or to be doing." And that was Peter. And as a friend, I knew his family home in Springs because of him. I remember one day on a Sunday, he came to my place. I was still at City Bank in Tembisa, just 3 minutes walk from Kubeni, where he had his house. And he said to me, "Hey, Madala, I've got a problem." I said, "What is it?" He said, "Hey, man, just leave everything that you're doing. I've got a car that is stuck somewhere and it's been fixed so that we can go and fetch it, we can drive it, and I'll drive the other one." He was driving a Passat, a brownish one, the old Passat those years in the early 80s. Unbeknown to me, there we were, to the east end. And meandering through, and we passed through Springs deep into Guatemala. Kanti, he was taking me to his family home in Springs. That was Peter. Many other things come vividly to my mind, program directors. Many, quite many. I think to a certain extent I became what I am because of his advice. There were times when I became a principal of Tembisa High School, and there were very serious problems those days. Not only in the school, but those problems and the pressures that came from the system, the government of the country, he advised me to stick in there. I want to say, in conclusion, fare thee well, my brother. Fare thee well, Madala. The family, Ausflow, you've got my back. The family, Tidi Sarang, Aselina Fela Lela Tlagetjuing, Leri Nakamukaba Hotel Bawera, Rela Tlagetju. Thank you very much. God bless you immensely and always. Thanks.
Our program directors, the Tlakwila family, Baram Pashlele, the community, the colleagues, and Batokamoka. I stand here as a family friend, representing all family members who were touched by Peter's life. Allow me to address Dr. Peter Percy Maladi Tlakula as Bra Peter, as P, as Pete, or as my good friend. Allow me again to address Dr. Flora Tlakula as Flo and Tlapiadi. Flo and I come from a way, way back. As I reflected on today, I had to really think about, by the way, when did I meet Peter? I met Peter in 1984 when he came into Flora's life. He found me there. Banyana Basiliti, Baram Pashel, in Limpopo, Banyana Baka Marasin Lika Mamroshud. So I was there. So when Peter rocked up, he found me. 1984. That time they were in Rangwe Hospital. And as the courting developed, Flora started to call Peter P or Pete. And I followed suit. And it later became my dear. And I thought, that one I can't go. And today I stand here to talk about P and to talk about Pete. And as I say, Richard Holeman, Flora and I, as by our parents, our mothers, were Bahatla, found themselves in Hampashele, among the Bapedi, Banababa Swarana, Bahatla Bafitle Bapeding. That's how Nal Flora, since I can't even remember how far back. So Peter had no choice but to also find me. Where do I start to talk about such a giant? Where do I start? You know, P was many things, but I just want to focus on a few. Loving and caring. Peter loved. Peter cared. He started by caring and loving Flo, and then I followed. I enjoyed the benefits. And then the children, and then the grandchildren, and the community. Peter was passionate in everything that he does. Hardworking. For those who know P, he hated lazy people. And Peter was generous. His generosity, I'm not only talking about resources, he gave himself. And he took every child, every African child to Peter, it mattered. And he would do it, he will give advice, as they already said, on business and everything. But he gave himself. And when he loved, he really loved. There's something that I want to say, you know, Flo has never tested alcohol. But Peter, because, you know, of his nature of loving and doing everything, in that house, in that kitchen, there's a singing kid say, life is too short to drink cheap wine. And that was P. He loved life. Peter loved and cared for Flo. He loved his children. He loved his grandchildren. But I must tell you, Peter had a very explosive behavior. And I'm saying explosive in front of doctors here. And they'll be thinking, oh my goodness, explosion, they'll be trying to analyze him. No, I'm not talking about intermittent exposure disorder. I'm not talking about IED. I'm talking about a passionate, explosive, loving person. I'm talking about P. Whatever he does, if he loves you, he loves you more. If you annoy him, then you will get it. You will get it. He'll be saying, Siri? Siri? This can't be. He was very dramatic. And when he related stories, You know, he would exaggerate, but we enjoyed it. He had a good sense of humor and, you know, highly excitable. I must tell you, Peter, when he wants to do something, he go for it. Even today, you know, I remember when he was telling me about going to buy a truck. You know, when there's road construction, there's always this truck that will be spreading water. I don't know what it's called. But when they're still gravel, but there will be this truck. And even today when I see it, the other day I said, Flo, I just saw Peace truck. Because he would be so passionate about what he does. Highly excitable, sense of humor, but very direct. Peter was very intense and direct. Tell it like it is. With P, there's no gray area. He laughed. When he laughed deeply. When you annoy him, he'll be saying, you'll get it. I'm gonna just give it to them. That's P. And yes, he hated mediocrity. And you can imagine how he felt today in this country of ours, where mediocrity is like, is the order of the day. And then Peter, you know, of late, we'll be talking about politics. And we say, Siri, every time I walk in, Siri, who do you think is gonna vote? These clowns. And because he just hated mediocrity. You know, I just feel the love that he had, the passion that he had, the going all out. Tlapiadi, you and I enjoyed Peter. He loved traveling. We traveled together. And you know, Uboinyana, when we were at Tsikama, we knew we couldn't just go over the bridge, but Peter would never leave us behind. And because he doesn't like something, he will tell us. And if something is not according to him, he will tell us. And we knew that because he didn't tell us because he didn't love us. He told us because he loved us. And he was believing in development, developing others. He used to say, you girls must go to school. And I think when I met him in 1984, I then moved to other things and moved to other things because he inspired me. Flo, in his explosive ways, you'll remember when we were in Zimbabwe, we had a beautiful time. And Peter, being Peter, when it was time for him to come back home, he left us there. He flew back, and we didn't know what to do. And he said, hey, you girls, what are we still doing here? And we still had another extra day. You girls, what are we doing here? And then we said, we are enjoying. He said, with these things, there were warthogs running around at the lodge. With these things, he left us. But lo and behold, when we flew back the following day, he was at the airport to come and fetch us, lovingly, as if nothing has happened. Flo, man, it cuts deep. The pain cuts deep, but we understand. May his soul rest in eternal peace.
You know, as a gynecologist, I don't understand how Peter managed, because this is what he will do on a daily basis. When you tell them 5 minutes, they take 10 minutes. The next speaker, it was supposed to be Dr. Lawrence Zwane, but instead it will be, oh, here is he. He has arrived, Dr. Lawrence Zwane. You know, when he's still coming, it reminds me of one thing. The first day I came to medical school and I met Bra Peter, there's one thing he told me. In this place, you fail and they chase you away. So you must read. Bra Lawrence.
Before Dr. Lawrence runs, if there are any colleagues who are around,
I would like to request you to quickly come to the front and just form a guard of honor around our departed colleague. If there are any doctors in the audience. Oh, they don't want to stand.
They're here.
Are there any doctors? Raise your hand if you are a doctor.
Plenty of them.
Okay, just come to the front and stand around and give a guard of honor. Even if you are alone. You know how difficult it is to deal with doctors. You really have to insist. I didn't know there are so many. Eh? We are in good hands. Thank you, colleagues.
Thank you, Program Director. Start by greeting Muruti first, who's our communicator with God. And then I will also greet the family, Yampashele. Unfortunately, during the week, we were not around, so I couldn't just make a showy, but I was there during the memorial service, though I would make sure I was away, but I made sure to be there. And then, of course, I want to greet everybody else, including our colleagues, family, friends, the whole community around the East Rand where Peter touched our lives. I'll be short and to the point. I've been told by the program that I should be short. You know, the first time I met Peter and knew him very well is when I went to Medunsa to go and specialize. He was actually just ahead of me. He had just qualified. And I was just from private practice, you can imagine, from general practice to go and specialize, to go and study. You know, he said to me, there's no way, my friend, the way you guys are carrying on, you're actually very blank. That's how we put it, frankly. You must study. You know, I said to myself, this is the man who's going to actually guide me. I actually attached him to him as a mentor who guided me throughout, more of a mentor than a colleague. And it took me actually gave me special attention. I remember when I was preparing for my final year, he was still residing somewhere in Lombardy East. He made it a special point that he gave me after hours classes to make sure that I actually make it in my exams. And as a result, I just cruised through. I passed my postgraduate studies in record time. Therefore, Peter, I'll be internally grateful to you, my friend. I'm indebted to you for what you did to me. I will never forget it. He was also just more of a colleague than a friend. We also had an interface afterwards, qualifying at RVP Hospital. Even there, he was a guide to me. He said, my friend, if you're in private practice, there's one thing you must know. There's what we call litigation. For you to avoid litigation, you must still read further and attach yourself to some of us who will guide you through. And I did exactly that. And I've never been sued in my private practice. I've been there. I practiced for 17 years. Before I actually retired. I'm retired now, doing other things of my well, of interest to me and my family. Peter, to me, I will always be indebted to you. Who I am because of you, Peter. I still want to say thank you in front of everybody else, which thing I've never done. I've never even told his wife, Flo. This I'm saying it for the very first time. Thank you, Peter. May your soul rest in peace. And then just a word of comfort to the family. Yampashele Lebo Chakula is the Read from the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. Blessed be God, even our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, but by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted. Let us be a conduit today of comfort to the bereaved family. Thank you.
You can sit down, colleagues. The next speaker is going to be Miss C.D. Matou. I think she comes from Zamakutle Hospital. White HR78, the engine is continuously running. I don't know whether it's running because you left it on or whether somebody is taking it away. So, rush.
Thank you, Mr. Program Coordinator. I'm Sister Tsidi Matlou from Zamokutla Private Hospital. I can take off the mask. Yes. Today I'm here to comfort the family of Tlakula. Firstly, I would like to say greeting to everyone, and especially the family, patient, and the congregation. Unfortunately, I couldn't connect on Monday when they were having the memorial service due to some technical problem. So I'm Sister Tidi Esafsat from Zamo. I'm the unit manager of maternity. I would like to say it is with utmost sadness that we gathered here today to pay tribute to one of our gifted obstetrician and gynecologist. It is also impossible that we may think or even consider that we may have words and means comforting Mrs. Tlakula family on the departure of their loving husband, father, and grandfather to the kids. In this hour of darkness, loneliness, and loss, we ask you to find light, Mrs. Tlakula, in the book of, and solace in the book of 2 Corinthians, verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle we dissolve, destroy it, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in heaven. Dr. Tlakula has been a pillar to many, a guiding hand to his family, patients, and colleagues. I know we will never be able to bring comfort and peace to all those that Dr. Tlakula has touched in his personal life or professional life. Who will now deliver or heal of so many that relied on Dr. Tlakula, especially those who are not yet referred to other specialists? Those patients now are just devastated. Some of them, they are not knowing where to start. To them, I would like to say, you are not left outside. Dr. Tlakula was working with a team, so there will be people who will be able to take care of you. Losing a doctor does not bring us any realization of our vision as a department and hospital, which is to achieve a safe delivery to all in our community. Dr. Tlakula was a very calm, devoted, passionate person. He was a mentor. During rounds, we know that we are going to learn a lot from Dr. Tlakula. So I would like to say, may his soul rest in eternal peace. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
thank you to the speakers that came before us. I'll call them the wiser generation because they took a bit of more time. So I see that, you know, in the next segment of our messages, it's more of the youth league as a bit, with just the exception of Ntate Tlakula. So I'm going to take an executive decision to say, can we kindly then make it 3 minutes as the speakers come forth to ensure that we give Moruti enough time to come and comfort us. You know, they say behind a great man, there is a woman of order, there is a woman of precision, and that's Mambule Flor. So I'm going to ask the speakers to emulate her as well as they come forward. I'm going to ask that Mrs. Dineo Tlakula to come forth and represent the children and the grandchildren. As she comes forward, I'm also going to ask the nieces, Jara Tlakula and Jara Mpahlele, to also get ready with their speeches as she descends the stage. But in the meantime, I'm going to ask, yesterday I think there were some great singers, you know, in our midst at the home. I know that we are mourning and yet at the same time, we're celebrating a giant. Let's emulate him as well. Let the singing, you know, be abroad. That is how we'll be comforted today and remember the work of Dr. Tlakula. So I'm going to ask that we please sing Sefela 135, Sedilaka. I'm going to ask the DJ as well and any other person who knows and can start it very well.
Reverend Pataki, program directors, Sechaba Samudimu, I would like to greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Tribute by Daddy's son, Lebogang Tlakula. Papa, I know that no matter what, you'll always be with us. When life separates us, I'll know it is only your soul saying goodbye to your body, but your spirit will be with us always. When we see a bird chirping on a nearby branch, I'll know it's you singing to us. When a butterfly brushes gently by us so carefreely, I'll know it is you assuring us that you are free from pain. When the gentle fragrance of a flower catches my attention, I'll know it is you reminding me to appreciate the simple things in life. When the sun shining through my window awakens me, I'll feel the warmth of your love. When I hear the rain patter-patter against my windowsill, I'll know your words of wisdom and remember what you taught me so well, that without rain, trees can't grow and flowers can't bloom. Without life's challenges, I can't go strong. When I look out to the sea, I'll think of your endless love for us and Tlapiadi. When I think of mountains, their majesty and magnificence, I'll think of your love for your profession. No matter where you are, your spirit will be beside us. Papa also taught us that if a man is not willing to downgrade their lifestyle for a year or two to have a lifestyle of a lifetime, then he thinks too much about what others think. Tlapiadi. That will be Mama. Lebu says, he knows it's not going to be easy, but Papa's endless love will continue to bind us together as a family. And one day we believe we'll rejoice together with him when God calls us home. And then tribute by the grandchildren, Malati and Mulebogeng. We will miss you and always love you. You taught us lots of skills which will carry and use in life, and that we must remember nothing is impossible if we work hard. Mlebogeng and Malati wish you to rest in peace, and they find peace knowing that the pain and the fighting is over. You are now pain-free, Papa. They may be sad about your passing, but they know that you are now with Jesus in heaven, smiling down on them. Malati says you take him to every single soccer match, and you cheer for him and his team. He asks that you carry on cheering from him, even in heaven. One thing that you told him is that education is very important. You would sit with him and assist and guide him through his schoolwork. You are very strict when it came to his schoolwork, and you always tell him, "Me, I don't like lazy people." Rest in peace, Daddy. That's from Malati Nlebogeng. And from myself, daughter-in-law, tribute to my loving and caring father-in-law, Pete Percy Malati Tlakula. You poured your heart into my dearest husband. You gave him long lessons and supported him in his highs and lows. You loved your grandchildren with your whole being. They were your happy and safe place. I marveled at how you never shied away from telling Mama how beautiful she looked whenever she would have a nice garment or a new hairstyle. I will miss our conversations about the economy and politics. As a father-in-law and father figure, your absence left a deep wound in my heart. It is said that you left when we were praying and pleading with God for your safe and happy return home. But your love and peaceful memories will always be our guide. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Tlakula. You remind me of the commandments in the Bible. The first commandment, which is a very important one, that says, you know, respect your elders, for your life on earth, your days on earth will then be multiplied. Ladies and gentlemen, if you recall that this is the only commandment in the Bible that actually has a promise. So to the children and us, nieces, nephews, may we emulate that, continue to respect the elders so our lives on earth or days can be multiplied to live as long and as inspirational as Dr. Peter Tlakula did. I'm going to ask my co-program director to assist me with the hymn, as then we raise the brother, elder brother, to please come and pay tribute to his beloved brother.
Mfundisi and the co-program directors, and greetings to all of you who have come to pay your respects to our brother. I'll start off, I don't know whether the 3 minutes will be okay, but I'll try. Okay, thanks. Thank you for the opportunity to pay tribute to Pete. To us, he was always Pete. We thank the Lord for his 79 years that he lived. You know, Pete passed on just 7 days after his after his 79th birthday. And we thank the Lord for his long life, because indeed it was a long life. And we thank him for the type of life that he led. We have heard the tributes from his patients, his colleagues, and all those who had association with him. He led a life of service. As Budu was saying here, doctors live by giving service to their patients, and he did that for the 40-odd years that he practiced as a doctor. The defining moment for Pete came when he had this heart attack. And the determined person that he was, he decided that, no, if I don't do X, then I won't come right. And he was so determined that he had to have the operation. I believe there were other forms of being treated too, but no, he elected to get operated. And to me, that told us that he had taken his life into his hands now and decided that, man, if I am going to go on, I must have this operation. And words that are in Psalm 23 so come to mind, that even if I walk in the, is it the shadow of darkness or the shadow of death, yes, you will be my guide. And at that time, Pete knew that this was what was going to happen. He trusted in the Lord, you know, and decided to do this thing of going through a tricky operation, which he said that, no, many other people have done this, so why shouldn't I go through it? And if we are to play God, maybe we should say that he wouldn't have gotten COVID if he hadn't gone to hospital. But that is for another day. We as siblings, it is just two of us remaining. It's Buti and I. And Pete was the middle child. I don't know whether one should go into these conspiracy theories about he was much more closer to our departed Pat and Stan. He was much more closer to them than to us two, we the older ones. So we hope it is no conspiracy that he decided to join the other two and leave us out here. He couldn't have willed himself to die to meet those. We will miss him. Oh, Pete, we will miss. You know, he had a very sly sense of humor. My wife and I were saying, I think we don't know. Because Pete was very sly in his own way and in looking at the funny side of life. He saw the funny side and made fun of it. In fact, we were looking forward to him coming out of hospital when Flo said to us, man, he is getting right. It must have been 10 days before. We just thought, man, he is going to regale us with stories about the people who looked after him and the hospital staff. And for alas, it wasn't to be. He didn't make it. To you, Florent, it has been said, you were such a dedicated wife to him. And we thank you for this. You were loving to Pete. He was loving to you. But when he went out of line, you put him back. He is gone now, but we know that he is with our Lord, who he was having problems with. He had problems with faith bits. But we know that at the end, he accepted faith. We want to say to Florent and the children, we are available for your shoulder to lean on. You know, God is no slouch. God usually doesn't give you something that you cannot cope with. See? And I'm sure in this case too, that will be the case, that you are going to have somebody who is going to be a refuge. And for us, you know that you have a shoulder to lean on. You know, Buti and I, you know, Mukadi, and, you know, other relatives that are with us here. Well, I must end up by saying that, hey, Shivambu ifambile, Shivambu wandonga, in fact, you know, in when we praise ourselves, we say, Vashivambu wandonga. Vashivambu are those who come from the north, and the Ndonga, who come from the north, and we call ourselves Vashivambu wandonga. And we're not pity. Go and greet them. Go and greet Kensani and Pet. Well, now that we believe in afterlife, I hope they are not laughing at us where they are and enjoying themselves. Thank you very much. Enko.
Thank you very much, Baba Tlakula. Indeed, if he was a man of humor, let's hope God has received him, even if he received his faith very late. And I know that the nephews and nieces have got very funny stories for us in terms of how they lived with their uncle, how much he actually, when he walked into a room, he really brightened up the space. He really inspired a lot of us, and he lived up to being that great uncle that we all try and emulate. First up is the Tlakulanis, Ntlamulo, and then I'm also going to ask the Mpahlele nieces to also just please make their way forward. I'm trying to push as fast as possible to ensure that 10 o'clock we give Muruti an opportunity to comfort us. We've also got two additional items on the program, which are quite important, which will be the slideshow, obviously, as we remember Dr. Tlakula, and also there's still some messages that need to be read. So I think in that order, as Nkamulo descends, then I'm going to ask them Mpahlele nieces to also then come on stage and then also do their dedication. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Program Director and Muruti. My name is Nhlamulo Tlakula. I'm the youngest of Etienne and Flora Tlakula's grandchildren, daughter to the late Nkensani Tlakula, Uncle Pete's younger brother. And I'll be sharing a few messages on behalf of the nieces and nephews of the Tlakula family. From Basani. Honestly, I'm still trying to get my head around it all. Suave, witty, larger than life, Uncle Pete is no longer. I had such hope that you would beat this and you'd come out telling us, as usual, Uncle Beat style, just how much you hated being confined in that hospital bed. How that attention was driving you around the bend. And then I saw it in my dreams. You laying down this boy to sleep, and then confidently walking peacefully into the light. Please greet all of them up in heaven, and please tell them how much I miss them dearly. Rest easy, Uncle Pete. Job well done. A good memory I have of Uncle Pete in the Tembisa days. I would cry next to my creche fence when I would see his car passing down the road. Rest in peace from Mabusha. Farewell, Uncle Pete. I miss that mischievous smile and your cool personality. Rest in peace, Dimeng. So long, Uncle Pete. You were not only an uncle. I remember you showed up at my home in Claremont, and you executed your Mkhongi duties with pride. Uzikhonzele phambili, Dr. Bartla Gula. What an easy and loving soul. We thank God for teaching us an uncluttered way of life through your being. Rest easy, Uncle Pete, till we meet again. Dr. Milit Lagula. Uncle Pete, you always had a way of looking at the funny side of life. I will miss your jolly and caring nature. Rest in peace, Ntakisi. My memories of Uncle Pete, always the most colorful. He always used to send me YouTube clips, and they were full of humor. They were full of humor, and I would often appreciate it. Uncle was very gentle with a dry sense of humor, and that was very special. Rest in peace, Dumisani. Uncle Pete, you taught me that I'm strong, although I don't always think that I am. Thank you for being you. The best part of being my uncle is that you are so much more than that. You will always be in my heart and soul. Love, Khanyisa. And finally, my dearest Uncle Pete, from as far back as I can remember, there are very few memories in my life that exist without you in them. From all the wonderful memories at your house in Lombardy and in Kempton Park, to your very frequent, often unannounced visits to my parents' house. The words, Shamos, just make me a cup of coffee. Or can you, girl, juice only, please. As you sat down on the couch with your legs crossed, those memories will remain etched in my mind. I'll miss the random phone calls from you, and even the times when you would pick up my dad back in the day to go out. I always used to get so angry, wondering why I couldn't join you. But I realize now that I'd be gate crashing on your quality time spent with your little brother, which was really reflective of who you were. Very intentional about making time and showing up for the people that you loved. To our later interactions as I grew older, debating your strong opinion on politics and all the clowns in the political sphere, and your keen interest in different business opportunities and the latest tycoons in South Africa, as you would say. You were extremely direct, sometimes lacking tact, a trait my mother often tells me I get from you. But it's only because of how passionate you were, Uncle Pete. You were always open to entertain any business idea I presented to you. I will miss you dearly. On the last day I saw you, the week before you went into hospital, we spent an entire day together. I remember driving home, feeling my heart feeling extremely full, happy that Bogolo, my daughter, was so blessed to have grandparents in her life, especially because you reminded me so much of my dad. This really hurts. Losing you feels like losing my dad all over again. I couldn't in my wildest dreams imagine that that would be our last day together, because you assured me that God, which you rarely refer to, had given you a second chance at life. But at the same time, I'm so grateful to God that we spent our last days together, some of your last days. I know you will continue to watch over us, as you always have. greet my dad, Auntie Pat, and Vivi, Malati, Shlombe, and Mafanele in heaven. I know you're sitting down with my dad, listening to jazz, trying to find the nearest hangout spot in heaven. Etela ikurula, famba kahle Shibombo.
Tabela, ke le dumedisa ka lena la Jehova e le nna Nthabiseng Makongoza, ke sepela le motswala ke Matshepo Palane. Re ditlogolo tsa mamogolo Flora Tlakula and our beloved Ramogolo Peter Tlakula.
On behalf of Dr. Tlakula's nieces, nephews and grandchildren from the Mpahlele family, we would like to read to you the following dedications.
Where do we even start, Ramogolo, to say goodbye to you who has seen us grow from infants to adults and has placed our own children on your knee? You were without a doubt our sternest, finest, and most industrious and lovable uncle, a real dapper man with a good ear for jazz, an eye for the arts, for the cloth, and of course for the very best of Mercedes-Benz since back in the days when yourself and Mamogolo had your twin cars, Jimmy and Jix. Growing up, school holidays were an absolute highlight because for almost everyone, we would come over to Tembisa or Lombardi to spend time with Ramogolo, Lebogang, and yourself. But Ramogolo, as much as we loved you, we could never actually take you anywhere. For example, there was that time when a waiter said that white wine and red meat don't go together, and you responded by asking, in whose stomach? And then there was that time you were brought a gas burner to sear your food at the table, only to ask why you must pay for it if you're going to cook it for yourself. These are just some of the moments we remember, Ramogolo, the lighter moments. But there were also many more when we were just in awe of you. You taught us by simply being yourself that one could be an expert in their field and yet remain open to opportunities and learning, but most importantly, to honest and hard work. To us, you were a true example of someone who lives outside the box and believes that one's only limitation is themselves. Thank you so much for your love, for your teachings, and for all that you were to us from Kiriboni, Thabiseng, and Tishang.
Ramogolo Peter was more than just my uncle-in-law. He was my uncle, a stern, no-nonsense man with a very good heart and sense of humor to match, an intelligent man, a man of class, a man of taste, a worldly man. This is what I will remember about him most. A big man with a big heart for me and for my family. I'm glad to have finally had the opportunity for him to affectionately call me son. Rest, Ramogolo, rest, from Neo Makongoza.
Ramogolo, we thank God for the gift of your presence in our lives. You were a consistent and present father figure and will forever embody the true meaning of uncle. Charismatic, swaggy, funny, and wise. We really always had the best chats with you, and the color of your stories will remain unmatched. You made time for each one of us such that we always felt seen. Our family functions will never be the same without you. Your laughter and your spirit will be missed. You were truly one of one, and there will never be another. Rest in peace, Ramogolo Peter, from Letona, Mashadi, and Lesego.
Hi, Ramogolo. Thank you for opening your arms to us. We'll miss the conversations and our vacations together. It was a privilege being your digital assistant and art critic and teaching you about Spotify so that you didn't have to record songs off the radio with your phone anymore. Education is important because one thing that no one can take from you is your knowledge. All you need to do to achieve that is read. Read your books and make little notes. Use a pen so that you never forget. If you read and pay attention, then you will unlock something much greater and be happier. These are the words that you repeated every time we were together. Your belief and motivation in us will be deeply missed. Your stories always made us smile, even if some were a bit exaggerated. Mamkholo would say, "No, Pete, that's not what happened." And you'd start laughing. You were neither an anchor to hold us back nor a cell to take us there. You were a guiding light whose love showed us the way. Our minds will stick, will still talk to you, and our hearts will still look for you. But our souls know that you are at peace. Please keep the chessboard ready for when we see you again. Love, Dikano and Tatisi.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I really did count on those tributes and dedications to bring out the charismatic character of Dr. P. I'm sure wherever he is asking himself, I know that you're mourning, I know that it is you're grieving, but also, is this how you guys are really celebrating my life today? Is this how softly you're going to sing? How am I going to enter the gates of heaven with such soft song? So I think let us thank God and know that there is a hymn written here. I'm going to try in my very deep voice to start a song. Hopefully we all follow in and we get into celebrating his life as much as we are mourning. And we thank God that in our midst, in the time that we have lived in, we lived with such a giant, we were blessed with such a man of character and goodwill. Modimo riahuboka, riahuboka, riahuboka. Can we all stand? Those who can stand, let us rejoice. Modimo. I guess there's a choir and they can follow me and they can emulate for me. Thank you. Ria huboka rinse rita bela win wahala lela rinse rita. I think that's more like it. That's more as we celebrate this giant that we're bidding farewell to today. I know our hearts are weak and our hearts are in sorrow, but let's also remember that the life that he lived, and he also wants us to continue with the baton that he has left. I'm also going to ask in this moment, Mrs. Duduzile Mtimunye Hluyo, his protege, to come and really give an inspirational story of her humble beginnings to where he is, and all because he was engineered, and she was engineered and excelled by the man that we are here to celebrate. Over to you.
Reverend Pataki, program directors, Mama Flo, the Tlakula and the Mphahlele family, Lebogang and Dineo, all friends gathered here, I greet you all in the name of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm going to proceed and read my tribute to Dr. Peter Percy Maladi Tlakula. In 1988, my mom fell ill and had to be brought to Johannesburg for medical attention. Since I was in matric, she left me with a family I was not related to in KZN. In March, it became clear that I had to drop out of school and come to Johannesburg to find my mom or my dad. It would be a while till I found out that my mom was taken to Mpumalanga for medical treatment. By the time I was able to find my dad, it was around June, and it was clear that I would not matriculate. In September, we traveled down to KZN to collect my things and to get a transfer letter from school. On arrival, one of my teachers begged me to stay. He would do anything to prepare me to write matric, even though exams were a month away. I wrote. I passed, but not with an exemption, which is what is now called a bachelor's degree entrance. I couldn't proceed to tertiary because there was no money to do that, and whilst my matric marks were low. My mom was back but sick, staying in my uncle's house in Tembisa. I spent a year in total despair. In January 1990, I asked a mother in church, Mama Maggie Mhlanga, to help me find a job to look after my mother. One Sunday afternoon, while standing at my uncle's gate, gazing at nothing, a black Mercedes-Benz drove down our street and stopped in front of my uncle's gate. A moment in history that changed my life, that of my mom and my children, whom of course at that time I did not have. Mama Maggie stepped out of the back seat and called me to come into the car. A tall, dark, clothed with so much dignity man sat behind the steering wheel. On the passenger seat next to him was one of the most beautiful ladies I'd ever laid my eyes on. She looked kindly at me and said, hello. They looked like people from a bioscope, what is now known as movies. I said, yebo ma. The man turned, looking at me above his spectacles and said, Ntombazan, we are Zugutini specialist. I had no idea. I froze. Mama Maggie whispered, umuntu specializing on something. I repeated Mama Maggie's words to him. He invited me to come to the 10th floor of the then Trust Bank building in Kempton Park the next morning. That was the first and the most important interview of my life. I failed it, but I got the job. I became a receptionist at Dr. Tlakula's rooms. A month later, he called me into his office and said, Duduzile, you have so much potential. Why are you not at university? I told him of my circumstances and that even if there was money to send me to university, I still would not qualify since my marks were low and it was to be another 3 years before I could turn 23 and get what was then called an age exemption. A week later, he said to me, Duduzile, I have spoken to a friend of mine who is a principal at Tembisa High School, Papa Ralph Mutibi, who spoke here earlier. He agreed to register you as if you are a full-time student. You will work here, we will get you books, you will read during work. In November, you will go and rewrite your matric. We cannot wait until you are 23 years old. In November, he gave me leave to go rewrite my matric. I got my matric exemption. He and Sis Flo almost popped with pride. They bought me my very first Steers lunchbox. He asked me what I wanted to become. I said, a lawyer. In January, he paid for my first year courses towards a BProc degree. I subsequently obtained a bursary from the then Genco Development Trust. A few years later, I was admitted as an attorney, having obtained a BProc and an LLB degree. Today, that little girl, who had no idea what a specialist was, is an acting judge of the High Court of the Republic of South Africa. Dr. Peter Tlakula remained a towering, protective father every step of the way. He missed no milestone in my life. He delivered two of my children who are here today and gracefully became a 24-hour on-call doctor stroke grandfather each time they sneezed. Dr. Flora Tlakula, my sis Flo, was always at pains explaining to me that my dad, Dr. Peter Tlakula, was an obstetrician and a gynecologist and that his work with babies ended in the delivery room and that my babies were actually safer if I consulted her on baby flu and stuff. But you see, to me, my dad, Dr. Peter Tlakula, was the doctor, while Dr. Flora Tlakula was my sis Flo. On Thursday, the 27th January 2022, Dr. Peter Percy Tlakula transitioned to glory, leaving behind a legacy of a life fully lived according to his name, Tlakula. He lifted and carried many. Mine is but just one of the stories of his life. He delivered and welcomed hundreds of babies into this world. Some have grown to be industry captains, making great strides in life. God has called him home and gave him rest. Akensa tatana. Minero yang mina ya bulabula. Yetlela yigurula. To Sis Flo, thank you for clothing my dad with so much dignity and class. He always walked tall with his head held high because of your presence in his life. May God grant you comfort that only he can. To Lebuhang and Dineo and the kids, thank you for allowing me to be your big sister, welcoming you into your home, and always gracefully sharing your dad with me and all of us. And to the entire Tlakula family, may God grant you comfort. Lebuhang, when your heart is no longer clothed with sorrow, continue to rise. You know that Daddy would have not wanted nothing less for you. I thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tutuzile. What an inspiring story. What a way to pay tribute to this man here. It reminds me of my favorite way of whenever I get to speak, I say to people that when someone touches your life, it should be in a simple format of A, B, C, D, E. And you, with your story, you've just embodied that Tate Peter Tlakula really did that. That A, he reminded us through your story that we have the ability to achieve anything that we put our minds to it. You know, we must also be really tackle life with boldness, braveness, and beauty. See, we are created as humans, all sitting here to conquer. You have conquered not having a bachelor's entrance to becoming, you know, an acting judge. D, we are designed as humans to deliver. Tate Tlakula not only delivered a lot of babies, but he's delivered an acting judge through his work and humility. And with the correct engineering in us, you know, family, support, and the right people behind you, we are engineered to excel. And that's what he always embodied. Excellence in everything that he does. Congratulations on being the acting judge, and also a job well done to Dr. P, and we thank him for his selflessness, and also Mamol Flo, because behind that great man, there's always a great woman with an open heart for him to help others. On that note, I'm going to ask 360 Global Solutions representative, Mr. Kandani Msibi, to come and pay his tribute. I'm sure it's going to be a daunting task after that speech.
Thank you very much, Program Director. The people that have been impacted by Dr. Tlakula are not competing. They're complementing one another because he's a man of many talent. To the Tlakula family and the Mpahlele family, I stand here on behalf of 360 Global Solutions Group. It is a company that acquired one of the babies that Dr. Tlakula helped deliver. As we have heard that he does not just deliver human babies, he also delivers judges, but he also delivered two babies that I'll quickly tell you about so that I can save more time, you know, for our pastor. In 1978, Dr. Tlakula and a number of other doctors, including Dr. Tlakula or Abna, they started two organizations, which is a Sizwe Medical Fund and a Chaba Medical Solutions. And Sizwe Medical Fund today has become a Sizwe Hospital Medical Scheme, and Chaba Medical Solutions has become 360 Health. Now, these organizations were established as a form of protest. And their form of protest, if you remember that it's just after 1976, their form of protest has always been education and entrepreneurship, in addition to the political struggles that many of them were involved with. And it is an interesting action that they took, in that today in this country we struggle with poor economic growth, we struggle with high levels of unemployment, and we lack people of courage who will actually start companies that will actually solve problems and also create employment. With this group of friends and doctors and business people, when they started the Sizwe Medical Fund, the black people were not allowed by law to become members of medical aid. or any medical fund. It was actually the apartheid days, when you remember. The Medical Schemes Act had a clause that defined a medical aid member and defined the medical aid member as a white person in employment. And they had one white person who was in their group of 38, and they used this white person to lobby the state. In those days, the fronts were the white people, because the state was a white state that was an oppressive state. And he lobbied the PW Botha regime to change the law from saying the member of a medical aid is a white person in employment to say it is a person in employment. And that is how CISO Medical Aid was born, and that is how black people were allowed to become members of medical aid. Today, CISO Medical Aid, CISO Medical Fund, has grown, merged with the HOSMED. It is called CISO HOSMED Medical Scheme, and it has over 65,000 members. This organization has been in existence for 43 years by now, and it continues to grow very strong. And Dr. Peter, Dr. Tlakula, Dr. Amna Tlakula mentioned the role of Dr. Peter and the family. And we know as well in the organization that if we wanted Dr. Amna Tlakula to agree to something, we had to speak to Dr. Peter first. And that was a standard that once Peter agrees, Abner will just go along with what Peter says. We refer to these gentlemen as our founding fathers, as ladies and gentlemen, that they are our founding fathers and founding mothers. We're that organization that always refers to them, and we honor them. And Dr. Tlakula, just to make one correction, the contribution is not from CISO Medical Fund, it is from 360 Health. You'll remember that the CISO Medical Fund is regulated and cannot make donations. So the donations comes from the administration. We would like to comfort the Tlakula and the Mphahlele family and the friends and the wife as well. That this man is a giant. We'll always remember him. We wrote a book about him and his colleagues that started CISO Medical Fund. The book is available on the CISO HOSMED Medical Scheme website. It is freely available. We never made it available for sale. We just made it available for free. And this is part of the tribute to a continuing legacy of a giant that worked with other giants in order to change the lives of people, and will forever remain grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Msibi. Clearly, this man is a jack of all trades and definitely a master at all of them. The next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is going to be Advocate Bantsi Tlakula. She's going to be reading the message from Mamol Flora. I think it's always easy to write the vows. It's something that you look forward to. But I can imagine, Mamolo, that right, you never really think that you will one day pen down a tribute to your husband. We all know that death is inevitable, but this probably was the most difficult tribute you could have ever written. In that space, maybe we can ask the DJ, just play a song for us as Advocate centers herself, and we're all going to listen to this tribute. It might not be your final tribute, but mostly the most important one tonight, today. Thank you.
To moya o halale la moya niti wachi se ho ke na di pilu tse bata ti tu ki swa.
Ntate Moruti and program directors, I've been requested by my sister Flora to read a tribute to her husband, Pete. I met Pete in 1984 while I was a nursing sister at Gerankuwa Hospital in Pretoria. I had no slightest idea that God was sending a great future husband my way. Not only was he a husband to me, we were the best of friends. There is very little that we didn't do together or didn't share as partners. My husband was a fierce and passionate human being. I'm grateful to God to have blessed me with a union that lasted 34 years. We were meant to celebrate our 34th wedding anniversary on the 7th of February 2022, but sadly, you are no more. Never in my wildest dream had I imagined that life would turn out this way. P was very special to me. Special because his understanding of marriage was not only about romance and intimacy. He understood that I was an individual first with her own mind. He gave me space to be the best of myself. I was not only a wife to him, but a business partner, a sounding board on both professional and personal levels. I wish I can confidently say that I am at peace and okay that you have passed on, my dear. The reality is, this is very confusing for me right now. There are days where I am at a loss for words to express any type of a feeling I could be experiencing. Some days, I kind of understand that it was your time to go. Some days, I do question why did it have to be now? Why this way? I feel blindsided by events because when you left for that fateful surgery on the 8th December 2021, you were very upbeat and remained hopeful that God has given you another lease of life. You understood that you had to have that surgery for a healthier life afterwards. Sadly, I find myself without you today, and it pains me so hard as I have not envisaged that I will be here writing about you in this manner. I mean, P, we still had so much we wanted to do together. For crying out loud, we had a holiday booked for the 28th December. In you, I had a best friend and a supportive partner any woman would have asked for. Yes, like many couples, we had a fair share of our challenges, but we persevered because before everything else, we loved each other. We cared for each other. We mattered to each other, and we wanted the best for each other. Painful as it may feel right now to me, I know that God's will has been done. I may not have been prepared for it. My faith is carrying me through this difficult period of my life. I may not understand the whys and the maybes. One thing I am certain of is our love for each other, and the price I am paying currently is for loving you deeply so. I guess it was expected to happen at some point, and I pray to God to give me the strength to carry on and to take care of our most priceless blessings, our grandchildren, Maladi and Mulebogeng. I may not be quite sure of how I will manage and navigate what's left of my life without you, but I do believe that you will be there with us in spirit, encouraging and guiding us through it all. I have known you to be that type of a man that loves, cares, provides for, and puts his family first. Our lives will never be the same, P, and it hurts thinking about it. Thank God for blessing me with a husband like you, my dear. Thank you for loving me and Lebogang the way you did. Thank you for loving my own family the way you did. Thank you for giving me another family in the Tlakulas. Ours was an everlasting love that triumphed over everything and anything. The memories we created and shared will sure comfort me as I begin this toughest chapter of my life without you. You may have left this world, but absolutely not my heart. My pain and tears are testimony to the love I have for you. I am richer in spirit because you had the generosity of spirit when it came to us and our love. No one is ever ready for days like this, P. I choose to trust in God, even in my confusion and pain. I trust and pray to him to strengthen me so that I can live my life cherished our love. Our love deserves to be celebrated, for it was the best I have experienced and the longest love I lived. I will miss you so much, my dear, for there is nothing we didn't do together or talked about. Even the most mundane of things were huge in our life because you were crafty and funny. You had a way with words and could even exaggerate things just for the effects and made me laugh a lot. I will miss that. In you, I have lost my greatest love, but through you, I have gained so much, P. Writing this tribute will never do justice to the quality and value of the love I shared with you. If I was to narrate what we did, achieved and did not achieve together in the past 34 years, it will take me 34 more years to narrate that. After all, we have been 34 years married. The kids and I will greatly miss you. We acknowledge and count ourselves blessed to have intimately shared in your life and generosity. You left a void in all our lives, and we shall hold on to the memories with you and seek comfort in that. Your passing, on the other hand, has blessed me and the kids with so much love, kindness, generosity, and support from people that knew and loved you. I've gained new friends from your friends, colleagues, patients, and appreciate our respective families even more as a result. Thank you, my dear, for all that you did for me, the kids, the grandchildren, our families, and the community at large. My deepest appreciation to you. You were one of the greatest in this world had to experience, and your contribution is commendable, even if I have to say so myself. I may be weak now, I may be hurting, I may be stunned, I may be everything, anything for that matter. Seeing you suffer in the last few weeks were the hardest for me. I may not have been ready for this eventuality, but I am consoled that you are no longer in pain, my love. You are resting with the Lord now, and that consoles me a bit. I am grateful, and God bless you. I miss you terribly, and it is well. May your soul rest in peace, my darling, till we meet again. Ke a leboga.
Ralebora advocate. And I think I speak on behalf of everyone here, Mamuholo, that take comfort in the word of God from Psalms 39 verse 18 that says, the Lord is closer and nearer to the brokenhearted and those that are shattered in spirit. Mogawa Mudimo awa parele. On that note, I'm going to ask Ms. Dimeng Tlakula to come and read the obituary for us, and I kindly ask that we all rise.
The obituary of the late Dr. Maladi Percy Peter Tlakula. Dr. Peter Tlakula was born on the 19th of January 1943 at Ilim in the then Northern Transvaal to Mr. Etienne and Mrs. Flora Tlakula. He was the third born son after Abner and Max, followed by the late Patricia and Stanley. The family migrated to Orlando East in 1944 and on to Painville Springs in 1945, where his father was tasked to establish the first secondary school in the area. The family finally settled in Guatemala Springs, where Peter spent his childhood. Dr. Tlakula matriculated at Lemana High School in 1962. In 1963, he enrolled at the University of the North for a BSc degree. On completion, he registered for his MBCHB degree in 1966 at the University of Natal and graduated in 1971. He established his first practice at Sidibeng Section in Tembisa, where his elder brother, Dr. Abner Tlakula, already had an established medical practice. He later relocated his practice to Ubeni Section, Tembisa, where he practiced for about 12 years. Dr. Tlakula left his practice to pursue his specialist studies at the then Medunsa, now Sifako Makato Medical School, where he qualified as a gynecologist and obstetrician in 1987. He was one of the first gynecologist to practice in the then East Rand, now Ekurhuleni. In 1989, he was admitted at the St. Mary's Royal Hospital in the United Kingdom, where he obtained his certificate in vitro fertilization, IVF. In 1990, he established his own specialist practice in Kempton Park. Practiced at the following hospitals since their inception: Delmo Private Hospital, Karibo Clinic in Kempton Park, R-Vape Medical Clinic, Zamukuhle, now Landmed Zamukuhle Private Hospital. In addition, he did sessions in Life Kastenhof, Eden Vale, and Bertha Tohwa Hospitals, formerly known as Jemestin Hospital. At the time of his passing, Dr. Tlakula had started to ease out on his workload and only practiced at Landmed Zamukuhle Private Hospital. Dr. Tlakula contributed to a number of community projects which benefited black students. He was founding member to the following: South African Medical Discussion Group, which was founded by the late Dr. Ntato Matlana, the late Dr. Mukesi, Dr. Bengane, Dr. Makena, and his elder brother, Dr. Abner Tlakula. The group funded black medical students. Tembisa Bursary Club, which provided funding for the learners at Tembisa Secondary School. Sizwe Medical Fund, the first black-owned medical scheme in South Africa. Lisedi Clinic in Soweto, the first black-owned private hospital. Dr. Tlakula was passionate and a committed family man. His love
His life was dedicated to his wife, children, and grandchildren. He loved spending time and playing with his grandchildren. His love for people extended to all that were dear to him. He will never miss an opportunity to encourage people he came across to do better. He shunned laziness and always encouraged people to work hard. He will be sorely missed by his family, friends, colleagues, and his patients. We will also miss his abiding sense of humor. He was quick to see the funny side of life. Those who were close to him were looking forward to him coming out of hospital to hear him make fun of his stay there. But to their disappointment, that wasn't to be. Dr. Tlankula succumbed to complications of a viral infection post-surgery at R-Vape Hospital on the 27th January 2022. He leaves behind his wife, Flo, as he affectionately called her, his son, Lebogang, his wife, Dineo, his two grandchildren, Malati and Molebogeng, elder brothers, Abner and Max, and his extended family. May his beautiful soul rest in peace. Etlela iko la shiba. Wena kuti wa etia wa adune wa eliu wa tagula mafuyata. Etlela iko la shiba.
Indeed, may his soul rest in peace. I'm going to ask that we please replay the slideshow as the nieces and some of the nephews read tributes or messages from the wreaths. But in order to save time, I'm going to ask Ntsakisi, Basani, and Penny to please read three messages each. And then the rest will then hand it over to the family to read at a later stage as Moruti also gets preparing to come forward. So I'll ask those three to please come forward, and I also ask that we kindly replay the slideshow, which is the memories of Dr. P.
To our loving grandfather, rest in peace, Daddy. We will always love and remember you, Molebogang and Malati. To our loving father, rest, Papa, rest. You have ran your race. We will always love and miss you, Lebo and Dineo. To Tlakula family, may the Spirit of the Lord comfort and heal your family. The Lord is closer to those whose hearts are broken. Lean on God. He cares and he loves you. From the Makubeza and Mueng family, your neighbors. To Mampolo Flora and the Tlakula family, wishing you comfort and peace to face the days ahead and loving memories to hold in your heart. May Ramkholo Peter's soul rest in peace, Matepo Palani and family. To Mampolo Flora and family, we extend our deepest sympathies to you and your family and pray that God will comfort you. May God give you strength in this difficult time. Kalerato, Hunadin Kadimen, and children.
Brapita, from Mphahlele brothers-in-law. O re tlogetse re sa gopola sebara sa rena.
re leboga tsholga ya abut pita amoya wa gago o robele ke khotso shibambu from Rodney Kaugelo Kibidu le matume mphahlela.
To Ramohol, you raised us and loved us as your own. We will dearly miss you. Much love, Ditlokholu, Liditlokholwana, Tsamashidi, Li Khapan. To us, you were a brother we could have ever asked for. You loved and cared about us like our own. We felt the love, and thank you so much, Awudiwarema. May your soul rest in peace. We will miss you with love, Ngele, Colleen, Mapili, and Junior.
Beloved ladies and gentlemen, we've come almost to the end of our formal program. For me, it's been an honor and it's been a privilege. Thank you to the Tlapgula and Phahlele family for giving me this opportunity to really steer this program of such a giant. My last words, before I hand over to my elder, my co-program director, to call on Muruti, is that, you know, may the peace and love of God be with you all, and may you all dwell in the house of the Lord. Thank you.
My co-director has already uttered what I was going to say. I'm not going to repeat it, but what I would like to say is that thank you. You have been such a wonderful crowd. You really did everything per book, and this is what Pete will have liked. But I only made one discovery, apology to Dr. Tlakgula, that you thought Peter was not the most brilliant. He was actually the brain behind. He was just a great thinker. And you use this thinking. We are going to only sing one hymn, one verse of hymn, 363, Di Fela Tsa Sioni, so that Reverend Pataki can come up and give us the word of God. I am a bit vocally wounded in some of the songs, so if there's anybody who can come to my relief, you can just start the song. We're reading from the book of Philippians, the letter that is written by Apostle Paul to the congregation of Philippi. And I'm just going to read two verses, which is 8 and 9 of chapter 4. And this is how the two verses read. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything praiseworthy and excellent, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen. Just to wrestle with what we are confronted with, fellow Monas. Paul writes a letter to the congregation of Philippi because the congregation was troubled by his parting ways with them. Parting ways in the Christian faith has always given a challenge, particularly to those who remain behind. But because the Christian faith is a faith based on remembrance and memory, we are encouraged that parting ways is never an end in itself, but it's part of a process that will allow reunion at a later stage. I am reading with you this letter because out of this letter, we will find comfort as we wrestle with the parting ways of Dr. Tlakula and those of us who remain behind. But before we could understand what is it that we are dealing with, before we could even comprehend what kind of pain we are confronted with, we must first accept who we are. We've got to accept that we are today a community in grief. We've got to accept that we are a community in mourning. We can't be identified in any other way possible except to accept that we have been placed in a weaker spot by the developments confronting us. And therefore we are weak. And when we are weak, we can only aspire to receive help elsewhere. But if we were to pretend we are strong, we will refuse to aspire for help. And that is where the danger of this parting of ways rests in. We are a community at a loss. We must accept that there is something we have lost. We are a community that is without inner peace. That is why we are a crying community. That is why tears are flowing down our cheeks. It is because we do not have the inner peace. But most importantly, we are also a community on a journey. You cannot be a community of mourning, a community in grief, a community at a loss, and stick to one spot. We've got to journey. We are a community that has to journey. Now, Paul, when he writes to the Philippians, he says to them, so that this journey, because this journey that we are engaged in must remove us from being a community of grief and mourning to being a community of hope and celebration. Now, to move from that one point of the extreme pain and hopelessness to the extreme point of hope and celebration, we must go through this journey. But Paul is quick to give us
mpao, mpao watsila, kuri anybody who is supposed to move from this point to this other point, what is expected of that community? What, in other words, what does God expect from us as a mourning and grieving community over the passing of our brother, our father, and grandfather? God, through Philippians letter by Paul, expects us to rely and to depend on memory. That is the only content that we find in this letter that could take us, the provision that could take us from this point to the next point, is to rely and depend on memory. And I like it because Paul says, when he writes, he says, finally, which means our restfulness in memory becomes the final dose that we need in order to transcend from grief to celebration, from mourning to hope. And he says, that content of memory is the following. It is prescribed. The content of the memory that will heal and comfort us family is prescribed. He says, we have to think only about those things that are true. I have listened to tributes this morning about things that are indeed true about our departed friend, father, grandfather, husband, and brother. We have to think about only those things that are noble in character. We have got to dwell on things that are right. The things that he did and said that were right. The things that he did and said that were noble. The things that he said and did that were true. We've got to find solace in things that are pure. Things that are without blemish, in other words. Things that are lovely. Things that are admirable. Paul says, we've got to look out for things that are of praiseworthy. I have listened to you even clapping hands in thanksgiving to some of the tributes that we listened this morning. And those are things that are of praiseworthy. Think, Paul says, to those who are remaining behind, think of those things. Think of the things you have learned, he says. The things you have received from me or seen in me, only those things that are attractive to you, he says, put them into practice. Then the formula ends up this way. The end of this formula is that once you do and say those things that you have found admirable and noble, and you put them into practice, then the end result is that the God of peace will be with you. That is the summary of what Paul teaches us. That the reason why we are in grief, the reason why we are in mourning, is because peace is lost to us. We are battling inside. We are struggling inside. There is conflict, there is tension inside. We're fighting emotions. We're fighting things we can't even see. And Paul says, only if you go back to memory and leave those things that he has enumerated here, then the God, it's an invitation to God of peace to come and be with you. And once we have got peace, we have got hope. Once we have got peace, we can celebrate. Once we have got peace, we can move on with life from where we are. Jesus Christ says, do this in remembrance of me. The Christian faith is about remembrance.
in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, blessed now and forevermore. Amen. Let us pray. Here we are, Father, before your throne once again in thanksgiving of the life of Peter, your manservant, one who has caused so much of inspiration to our lives, one who has lived amongst us and became one of us. And yet today, when he lies in silence, we cry, we grieve, we are in mourning, because we are parting ways with his physical presence. Multiply our joy in his memory, that when we think of him, we can only be happy. That when we think of him, we can only give respect and praise to you and to the life that he led. Leave this place with us as we go to the cemetery where we shall commit his remains to the ground. Remain with the family. Strengthen them each time, because there will be morning and there will be sunset. They will feel lonely, and yet in memory, they are not alone. You, God, are with them. We pray for the colleagues. We pray for everyone else who has been touched in one way or the other by this development, the sad parting of ways with one of us. Heavenly Father, we know your love is sufficient. Your grace is sufficient. You are with us because your name is Emmanuel, God with us. All this in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
One verse from hymn 363. Again, can you start this for us again, please? While I'm asking Mr. Dumisani Takula to stand up and come and make some announcement. But before he speaks, I'd like to make another appeal. We were very well behaved with respect and decency when we came in here. When we have to go out of this hall, let's allow the remains of our beloved brother, father, doctor, to be taken out, followed by the family. We all stand up and only go out once the family is out. And when we proceed to the graveyard, I know there's always this trend of everybody running to the graveyard, up to the extent that when the family arrives with the hearse and so on, they can hardly get any place to drive. Let's show that respect and follow from behind. There will be Metro Police who are going to actually direct us. Let's listen to them. They'll help us a lot on our way to where we're going to. Dumisani.
Thank you very much, Program Director, and Reverend, thank you for those comforting words. Mine is very short this morning, just to announce that from here we're going to be moving to the Lalangoxolo Cemetery, where part three of our program is going to be taking place, and we shall be returning here where lunch is going to be served. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Paul Barros.
Can the owner of Mercedes-Benz RLN 906 GP please kindly move your car? You're blocking the hash. RLN 906.
Thank you.